Good evening. Welcome. Thank you for coming tonight. My name is Professor David Skidmore, and I teach in the Political Science Department here at Drake, and I'm also Director of the Principal Financial Group Center for Global Citizenship, which is sponsoring tonight's event. And I want to mention a couple of upcoming events that the Center will be holding. On March 1st, so a little over a week from today, we'll be hosting a talk in this room at 7 o'clock by Peixing Zhou. Peixing is a sociologist from Nanjing University, and she's here this year through our Global Practitioner Program. And she's going to speak about the invisible curfew, women's fear, and their use of public space during China's urbanization. So that should be quite interesting. And then on March 8th, a week later, we're going to be having a panel discussion also in this room, 7 p.m., featuring economists from Principal Financial Group and also the CEO of Pioneer Hybrid. And they're going to, the topic of the panel is going to be the end of the commodity super cycle, implications for the U.S. presidential election, the world economy, and beyond. These are always, you know, quite lively events, and we always look forward to having one of these global economy panels each semester. So I'm very happy tonight to welcome our speaker, Professor Michael Renner, who is a professor in biology and environmental science. I'm on a committee that actually reviews and approves faculty proposals for funding proposals for international travel. And so Michael's proposals are always interesting. He said, you know, basically they come down to, I'm planning to go hang out with chimpanzees in Rwanda. And as I thought about that, I thought, there must be a good story there somewhere, I'm sure of it. So I asked Michael to come and to talk about the research that he does in Rwanda and perhaps some of the student experiences as well, since Michael's taken students to this project and involved them in his research. So please join me in welcoming Michael Renner.
Good evening. Good evening, everybody. First of all, I'd like to thank Professor Skidmore and the Center for inviting me here this evening. I discovered that even though I've been here 7 years, I was in another job for a while, and this is the first time I've actually stood up in front of a group of people and talked about my research. And so I've been kind of looking forward to this. It's important to say that I didn't do all of this work by myself, and that none of it would have been possible without support from a lot of different places. The list here is pretty long. It includes the Great Ape Trust, which is no longer in existence, and the Forest of Hope Association, which is a non-governmental organization in Rwanda that took over when the Great Ape Trust withdrew its activities in Rwanda. Dean Keith Somerville is one of my closest colleagues. Ben Beck was at the Great Ape Trust when they were in operation here. A number of places at Drake University have supported this work. In addition, some of the things we have done more recently have gotten grants from the U.S. Soccer Foundation, the Drake Soccer Program, the Vision Soccer Academy out of Waukee, and the Gishwati Foundation, which is a group of us formed to support the work I'll be telling you about this evening. And now I'll start with a confession. When Dr. Skidmore asked me to talk, I said sure, and then we eventually found a date. And then he asked me for a title, and I had what seemed at the time to be kind of a fit of creativity, and now in hindsight looks more like a fit. So I have to tell you where part of the title came from. And so there's a bit of a prelude to the story. Fall of 1977, I was a first-year graduate student. I was 20 years old. I was playing football in the park with a bunch of other graduate students, and I made what I will modestly describe as a rather spectacular catch. And the fellow who was covering me got so agitated by this catch that he forgot for a moment that it was flag football, and he made an equally spectacular tackle. And that resulted in 12 weeks in a cast. Since that time, lousy knees have been one of the recurring themes in my life, because this was an era before arthroscopic surgery. This is when they didn't know how to repair your ACL, so if you tore it, they just took it out. So I've had wobbly knees now ever since 1977. But it hasn't slowed me down a lot. I did research for 5 years in the Sierra Nevada mountains. Yeah, that's me in the hat. And then I worked at the Philadelphia Zoo on bears and great apes and monkeys and all kinds of critters for about 12 years when we were living on the East Coast. And then we fast forward to 2011. At that time, the Great Ape Trust was a going concern, and they had two major projects going on at the same time. One of those was the Bonobo Research Center here in Des Moines. It is now called the Ape Conservation and Cognition Initiative. I do part of my work out there when I'm in town. And the other is the Gishwati Area Conservation Program in Rwanda, and that's where I'll be telling you most of the story tonight. But the reason that's particularly relevant is that the Great Ape Trust scientists were also adjunct Drake faculty for the most part. They were teaching courses in biology and psychology and in our primatology program, which meant that they had Drake faculty email addresses. So one night, when I sent an email to the campus and said that I was going to step down out of the role of provost and get my life back, they got this email. And an hour later, literally like somebody had punched a clock, an hour later I got an email from Ben Beck, one of the scientists there, who said, "You used to be a pretty good primatologist. And I noticed that you're going to have some time on your hands. And we have this problem in Rwanda we don't know how to solve. And we're hoping you might be interested in talking about being involved in it." So an hour later, I had something to do. And 3 months later, I was in Rwanda, and that's sort of where we go. That's where our story starts. First of all, where's Rwanda? Rwanda is about 30 degrees east of the Prime Meridian. It sits almost on the equator, just a hair south. Our study site is about 2 degrees south. Just to put you in orientation, there's Rwanda relative to the equator, relative to Uganda up here. There's Tanzania, there's the DRC, the Democratic Republic of Congo. Kenya is over here. This was a slide I actually put together for the parents of students who were thinking of going with us in the J-term class that just got back 4 weeks ago. Ebola's 4,000 miles that way. So it's not something you really particularly have to be concerned about. But in terms of full disclosure, the Zika virus was discovered about 100 miles north in 1947. The Albertine Rift area of Africa is a really interesting crescent-shaped area that runs from the northeast to the southwest along the eastern side of the continent. It ranges from the northern end of Lake Albert to the southern end of Lake Tanganyika. The reason it's interesting is that it is the place where the Somali tectonic plate is separating from the African plate. They are pulling apart, and that allows things from the core to get up closer to the surface than they do in most other places. And so it's volcanically a very active area. Rwanda sits right on the Albertine Rift, and that's what that area is called. The Albertine Rift Valley through Tanzania and Kenya is where the most of the major fossils in the story of human evolution have been discovered. And so we're in a scientifically very important area. It's also an area of incredible biodiversity. Rwanda is known as the Land of a Thousand Hills. It's formed from a volcanic hot zone, mostly in the west, but throughout the country. And it is an area of tremendous biodiversity. It's one of the planet's biodiversity hotspots. And so you find all kinds of interesting creatures there. It's a very rural society, but what's unusual about it is that it has very urban population densities. It is the most densely populated country in Africa. It is an area for the entire country about 23% the size of Iowa, and there are 12 million people. So about three times our population. So it's a very densely populated area. And so even when you're in a rural area, you don't go very far without finding human settlement somewhere. It's mostly non-mechanized. And to the extent that there are beasts of burden, they are bicycles more than anything else. There are not four-legged beasts of burden. They do have livestock. There are goats and sheep and cattle, but they don't use them to carry things. When they carry something that they can't carry themselves, there are some vehicles, but not nearly the density per population that we have. Mostly they use bicycles. Schools typically are run on two shifts. So there's a morning shift and an afternoon shift. And when kids are not in school, they're working. They start working at a very early age. And it has been since the 1994 genocide that the availability of clean water was relatively widespread in the country. That was one of the first major initiatives of the new government, was to put at least a well that provided clean, safe water within reasonable walking distance of most homes. Now, I'll tell you, one of the most sobering moments I had my first trip to Rwanda was driving down a road, and seeing a kid who was about 3 years old carrying a gallon jug of water up the hill, all by herself. And that was her job, was to walk down to the well and get water. And they spend something like 25 to 30% of their time just hauling water so that they can do the things we all take for granted. Wood and charcoal are the primary fuels, and that's contributing to deforestation, because to make charcoal, you have to burn wood. This is a charcoal bin where they build up these walls, they interleave wood and leaves, and then they light it and then cover it with dirt so it only partially combusts. It dries out completely, but most of the energy is still stored, and so it's a very lightweight fuel that burns hot enough and lasts a long time so they can cook with it. But it sometimes has collateral damage. That's a hillside where they had set up several charcoal bins, and they had, the fire had tipped out of them and then it burned the surrounding countryside. Soccer is a national obsession. Every kid in Rwanda can tell you what's going on in the English Premier League and probably the Champions League in Europe at any given time. The games are on television. It's something, if you can find a television, you'll find 50 people gathered around it to watch the game. And they often play under very tough conditions. That field actually had a place, if you're a soccer fan, had a place on it where, from a corner kick, about over here, you were above the top of the goal and had a direct line of sight into it. So if you had any kind of foot at all, you could score, because there was nothing between you and the goal, and that's a corner kick. A goal kick is a totally different thing. And some of these kids have just mad skills, because they spend hours a day, you know, playing, sometimes with balls like that. I took a picture of that ball. It was actually in use, and I borrowed it for a minute to take a picture of it. Most of all, Rwanda is a land of paradox. From very primitive conditions, you find this along the side of the road that we use to get into our field station. When they graded it and plowed it about 8 years ago now, they thought as long as they had that heavy equipment out there, they would drop a fiber optic cable along the roadbed. And it still sits there dark. They thought it was cheaper to do it then than it would be to do it later, and they're waiting for a need for it. But there's a tremendous amount of forward planning that goes on in this country. And then we come to the elephant in the room. Everything you see in Rwanda essentially has been invented in the last 20 years. The genocide of 1994, by most estimates, killed nearly a million people in roughly 100 days. With regard to the proportion of the population affected, it was the worst mass genocide in the history of the planet, as far as we can tell. The government that exists now was invented afterwards and has been built up with a lot of foreign assistance, but is built up essentially from nothing, because at the end of this period of time, in the summer of 1994, there was no government, the society was broken, everybody was confused about what had happened and traumatized by it. Something like 80% of the people in the country know someone who was killed in the genocide, and 95% of the children in the years afterwards believe that they would not live to adulthood. So it covers everything. Gishwati Forest itself, which is where I'll tell you most of the story, is an Albertine Rift montane rainforest. It's from 2,000 to about 2,500 meters above sea level. So it starts at a fairly high altitude. It's locally also nicknamed the Forest of Hope. And so you see that phrase showing up periodically. It's also a biodiversity hotspot. You see servals and jackals. That's a mountain monkey. And that's Ruhira, who hates me. up in the tree there is a chimpanzee who's the head of one of the family groups, who just throws a fit every time I come within sight, and then will take his family and leave town. So I don't know what I ever did to Rahira, but Rahira's one of my favorites because he's very opinionated about stuff. And to put things into context, all of this work at Gishwati happens essentially within sight of Volcanoes National Park. It's about 50 kilometers across the tops of the mountains. This actually I took from a trail inside Gishwati Forest. And that peak you see off in the distance is Mount Makenyo, which is one of the five volcanoes in Volcanoes National Park. So you can see where the peak of that is. That is one of the points that defines the border between, at that point, the border between Rwanda and Uganda. Volcanoes National Park is the Virunga volcano chain, the massif. It is split among three countries. Parts of the volcano are in the Democratic Republic of Congo, parts are in Uganda, parts are in Rwanda. The most famous and most accessible mountain gorillas in the world are those on the Rwandan side of the mountains. So this is all wonderful. What's the problem? Well, the problem is that Rwandan forests have been disappearing at a fairly frightening rate. What you see in this diagram is the extent of Gishwati Forest circa 1978. And then in this hatched area here and here, there were two pieces of it left in 1988. And by 2010, this is what was left.
Yeah.
And that is characteristic of a lot of African countries, particularly Rwanda. With the explosion of the human population, with the absence of anything like governmental supervision in the post-genocide era, when 2 million refugees who had been in neighboring countries, sometimes for decades, trying to avoid the violence that eventually ramped up into the genocide, came back when it was over, when they believed it was safe, and there was nowhere for them to go. The lands that they had had before they fled were now in the possession of others, and there was huge confusion about land tenure. Much of the forest was clear-cut by people who thought they could turn it into farmland. And what people didn't know is that rainforest ecology is all based on rapid turnover of nutrients. There's almost nothing stored in the soil. All of the nutrients in the ecosystem are stored in the plant, in the biomass, in the plant matter. And so when you cut down the forest, what you have left essentially is a clay. Because the rain comes so often and so fast, it leaches all the minerals and nutrients out of the soil. So if they're not stored in the biomass, they just go downstream. So when you cut down a rainforest, you don't get usable cropland, you get empty land. And it can usually be turned into grazing land, but you're not going to raise good crops on it for a good long time. So the reforestation is really a big issue. So I'm going to tell you a story tonight that has several chapters. What's interesting about the chapters is that every one of them is partially written. It's a work in progress. And so what I want to warn you about now in terms of full disclosure is don't wait for a big finish or a grand conclusion when I'm done, because none of these stories is finished yet. We are in process building a bunch of things. And I guess the reason the story is interesting is this is how many environmental science kinds of projects go these days. You end up with your hands on lots of different parts of the system, because as much as I got interested in this because I'm interested in primates, as well as other animals, but you know, I was there because of the primates, you can't just work on the chimpanzees. You can't create the environment where the chimpanzees will survive into the future unless you deal with the system level issues at a much broader scale. And so we've ended up working on many things at a much broader scale than we expected, even though our point of entry essentially was environmental science studies of primates. So chapter one is attempting to restore the forest. How do you go about doing that? To tell you something about just how much this story is still unfolding, the Rwandan parliament passed the law to declare Gishwati Forest a national park in September of 2015. The legal document, like the Federal Register in this country, is called the Gazette in Rwanda. And the Gazette that included the official definition of the boundaries of the park was issued 3 weeks ago. So Gishwati Mukura National Park formally, we knew it was going to exist, but it formally exists as of February 1st, 2016. This is the current Gishwati section of Gishwati Mukura National Park. The area over here was the area that I circled in the larger map I showed you a few minutes ago. That's what was left circa 2010. Over the years between 2007 and 2012, mostly through the work of the Great Ape Trust and the funding of Ted Townsend, who was the underwriter for the Great Ape Trust, they acquired two additional parcels of land there and there, and those were allowed to begin natural reforestation. They informed the local people that this was not land in private hands, it was being used for preserves, they needed to leave it alone so it could grow back, and it is growing back, you know, rather grandly, pretty aggressively, but it's still being reforested. The original plot is not truly primary forest, it's not truly undisturbed, but it's in pretty good shape. That was what was left, and the borders were encroaching toward the middle over time, but that part of it was pretty much intact. As of February 1st, this area here became part of the national park, and this actually is what was originally one of the study sites I'll tell you about for one of the other studies. So it is still to be reforested. When I was there in January, it still had crops on it. One question is, can you accelerate the natural reforestation process with ficus, which is a genus of plants that includes the fig tree, and that's why they're interesting. First of all, it's a native species to the Albertine Rift. So ficus are found there. This is not bringing in an invasive species or an alien plant for the purpose of this project. And they're considered fallback food for chimpanzees. Figs will carry a chimpanzee population for a good long time. They're not totally complete nutrition, but they're frankly probably as good as the dog chow we feed our dogs in terms of complete nutrition for dogs. They do a pretty good job. They have a pretty good mix of amino acids, a whole lot of carbohydrates, a lot of calories. Chimps can subsist on figs for quite a good long time. And so if you can create a forest that has enough fig trees in it, then you've created a forest that can support a population of chimpanzees. And chimpanzees are not the only animal that's important, but they're the keystone species. They're the one that you look at to see if everything else is okay. If the chimps are okay, everything else is probably fine. If the chimpanzees are in distress, then the ecosystem is probably in distress. What's interesting about ficus from that perspective is that ficus can be propagated from a branch cutting. You can whack off about a 4-foot chunk of wood from a living ficus tree, and as long as you don't let it completely dry out, when you put it in the ground, if you keep it moist, it'll probably sprout roots, and then it'll start sprouting leaves, and a few years later, you'll have a functional plant. And so it can be very inexpensively propagated in the hypothetical sense, under ideal conditions. We didn't know whether this would work at the high altitude, which then sometimes dries out between the rainy seasons, that we find at Gishwati. So, in 2011, we set up a trial, and this was just as I was getting involved. I was actually not involved in the initial planting. I've been involved in all the follow-up. Where they planted 400 cuttings in this area of the second edition, and the reason that area was chosen was actually fairly pragmatic. That's only an hour's walk from the nearest road. When you get up into here, you're talking about 2 to 3 hours walk from the nearest road, not to mention a fairly substantial climb. And so the guy with the bad knees is saying, no, over here is good. This is the two Drake students who were there in 2011, and you'll see a thread of Drake students, including some students who were there last month, are sitting here tonight. I've been very fortunate in being able to secure funding from various sources that we've been able to take students from Drake to do some of this work in Rwanda. Nearly every year we've been going there. So in 2012, I had a crew out there where we were just verifying what proportion of the trees that had been planted as branch cuttings were still alive. You know, is this working at all? And tracking down 400 trees in this kind of territory is not the world's easiest task. And then after this trip was the first knee replacement. And then a year later, we went back with a much more ambitious data collection scheme to not only find them, but to take all kinds of typical plant vitality measurements. How tall are they? How many leaves are they? You know, what is the general condition of the plant? Is there evidence of new growth? That's Avery Loris. She's in graduate school at Oxford Brookes University in England now, working on primate conservation. And in 2013, we gathered a very large data set to look at the ongoing survival 2 years out of this group of plants. And after that trip was the replacement of the replaced knee that didn't take. The end of the knee story. 4.5 years later, now jump forward to January 2016. This is what a ficus cutting can look like 4.5 years later. Under the right conditions, they take off. Good initial survival in terms of the standards of horticulture. The long-term vitality of the plants turns out to be very dependent on the very local, very micro conditions around that particular plant. We actually accidentally did a pretty good experiment with plants further up on the hillside and more exposed, plants further down in flat areas, in moist areas, in shade, in sun, and the pattern was very clear when we went back in 2013, that the plants that were getting sun but had shelter from winds and drying conditions were doing better than the plants that were just up on the hillside somewhere. In fact, most of the plants on the hillside had died. So in 2016, the Drake students who went for this J-term class spent a day planting ficus cuttings. The Gishwati Foundation and Drake University both chipped in the funds to pay for the cuttings. We planted 300 cuttings, and frankly, some of the local people were there. They insisted on doing most of the work. But we got to participate in planting 300 cuttings of new trees. Further into that area that I showed you on the map, So it would be a longer swath of ficus trees for the chimpanzees to feed on when this is reforested enough for them to use it. This is the students and the local committees to protect the forest, of which each village around the forest has such a committee, that came out to do the work that day. And I want to tell you about my buddy Kabenga there, who's laughing at me at that point. I've worked with Kabenga every trip I've been there. He was a trail cutter when the Great Ape Conservation, when the Gishwati Conservation Program was there. He does incidental work for us now. He's the chair of one of the village's committees to protect the forest. Kabenga has the local distinction of having been struck by lightning twice. He's still smarter than I am, but he has some really interesting opinions about weather from that experience. So that's chapter one, still in progress. We are now reforesting and trying to selectively accelerate the reforestation using plants that will be of utility to the animals so that they can use this landscape quickly as it gets back into forest condition. And then there's forest fragmentation. Rwanda has lost 99% of its forest cover between the years of 1950 and 2009. And that restricts the available biological resources to certain sectors and certain townships and certain villages, so it's no longer distributed around the country the way it was before. Ecologically, even more important than that, it means that there are isolated small populations of both plants and animals that are no longer ecologically viable. You don't have enough genetic material, essentially, to avoid inbreeding problems when you have an isolated small population. And so the forest fragmentation is not just a hypothetical problem, it is a practical problem if what you're trying to do is build a sustainable forest for the long term. So the solutions to that include reforestation, which we just talked about, and they include building corridors to interconnect these isolated fragments so that animals can move back and forth. And what we don't talk about all that often is that animals are often an important carrier of plant material. When animals ingest plants, then they leave their fecal material in a new place. They sometimes get burrs and things stuck to their fur, which are to us an irritation, and to the plant, you're now a cargo carrier because that's a seed. And so plants move around a lot because the animals interact with the plants and the animals move around a lot. So if you facilitate the animals moving, you're also facilitating many of the plant species moving through that time as well. This is a couple of examples of constructed corridors that are in some way artificial, but they kind of illustrate the purpose more cleanly than some of the other pictures I'll be about to show you. This is an area that's experiencing human development. These are housing developments. And they left what they are calling green spaces, but they also serve as ways for wildlife to move through without having to enter the space that is, you know, clearly developed for humans. My house backs up to the Walnut Creek along the close to the Clyde Greenbelt Trail. And the amount of wildlife that uses that as a corridor, even in you know, suburban Des Moines, is pretty remarkable. If you're watching in the woods, you can see all kinds of critters back there. When you're going to build the corridor, what you want to do is integrate it with the landscape and build it in a way that won't be disruptive to what's already there any more than necessary, so that people will leave it alone, so that people won't encroach on it and cut paths through it. And there are a number of different kinds of impediments that you find to building a good corridor. Some are ecological, places like land cover that isn't suitable for animals. That can hypothetically be fixed unless it's something about the soil or the location where the proper cover for animals won't grow there. Slopes that are too steep, altitudes where animals won't go, and you are up into the 8,000 to 9,000 foot elevation range in some of the higher areas here, so that becomes an issue in Gishwati. And then how animals choose to move through the landscape. You have to work with that rather than just saying, here's your road, you have to use it. You know, they won't just use it when you tell them to. There are also social impediments, essentially the human factors. There are structures like roads and bridges and power lines and things like that that you have to take into account. And the tool we use to try to fit all this information together is geographic information systems. So this is just to illustrate the kinds of information you can get into a GIS data set. This is a contour line where everything along that line is the same elevation above sea level. This is marks for human artifacts like houses and things. Here's a mark for a stream. So you can code a lot of information efficiently and visually into this kind of a data set. When you look at the ecological resistance in the Gishwati area, we're now talking about trying to build a corridor hypothetically from Gishwati, which is up at the top here, to Makura Forest, which is a forest fragment much like Gishwati, somewhat larger, but completely devoid of anything larger than a serval. There are no primates there, quite a few bird species, including some endangered species, very few large mammals at all. And so it's almost a barren forest fragment. So what the idea was originally was to connect Gishwati with Makura, and Makura to Nyungwe, which is an intact rainforest at the southeast corner of Rwanda. It is about 400 square miles, and it's extraordinary.
What are the distances?
Actually, I'm going to get to that. I can tell you in more detail. This is in 50 miles-ish, which is 7 hours on the roads. It's a long story. The complications in terms of mapping social resistance, I'll go back here for a minute. This is the stream map in this region. One thing you have to know is that chimpanzees really, 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 really don't like water. And so getting them to swim is a non-starter. You have to provide pathways that let them navigate this landscape where they will not have to go through water. Now, a small enough stream is going to have trees touching or at least connecting closely enough that they can jump from one to the other over the top of the stream. But a big enough water course is a genuine impediment. And so building a corridor that expects them to cross that stream is a losing proposition because they just won't do it. To map social resistance, it becomes very complicated because Rwanda doesn't have zoning regulations. They don't have plot maps. They don't have a lot of the things we take for granted in terms of managing real estate and property rights in this country. And they don't have a legacy of planning. There is no history of deciding what's going to be done with a particular piece of land. This is a map that Drake folk put together that maps every human artifact in this piece of territory in the Gishwati to Makura area. They went through with high-resolution satellite photography and GPS coordinate tracking software and mapped the location of every building on the landscape to try to find places to put corridors. That's too many dots. And so you collapse that data by using mathematical algorithms that we do what's called smoothing that combines it into a representation of how densely packed are those dots in various places of the landscape. So you see places like here where there is a very high density of such dots. You see places like here where there are very few, perhaps none. And so you can mathematically condense a lot of data into something that's a lot easier to understand. And that modeling produced three plausible pathways from Gishwati to Nyungwe. Because that was the original question. Makura was an afterthought that was added later. And we'll characterize them as west, central, and east. Adding a 50-meter buffer on the side of a 200-meter, two football fields more or less, 200-meter corridor with 50 meters of buffer zone on the edge of where you can't do anything there, but we're not going to try and keep it natural. We're not going to try and keep it as an untouched forest. Didn't really change the locations of the paths. And the three pathways are very different in terms of how you would accomplish it, what it would cost, and what do you have to get out of the way in order to do this. The western route, the orange here, is the most direct, straight from one to the other. It's the most direct, so it's shortest, which then reduces the cost of acquiring the land. The central route, which is the purple here, had some really surprising places where, for no good reason, there weren't a lot of buildings there. And that made that a much more attractive proposition than was expected. But the central route joins up with the western route, or the eastern route, sorry, just south of Makura. And so they are the same from this point southward. The eastern route is the one that connects Makura to Gishwati and Nyungwe. It was the kind of original, how would we do this intuitively? It's the longest route, but when you subtract out the part of it that is actually within Makura, where you don't need to build a corridor because you already have the forest, it actually gets down to the point where it's not dramatically longer than the central route. And so you're using all this data to sort of do a cost-benefit analysis of where's the best place to put this corridor. So we came up with this table that identified what's the best option in terms of each of several variables. So that the tan color there is the best, the lighter green color is the second best, and the darker one is the worst. On each of a whole bunch of different variables. That was the point at which the proposal was presented to the Rwandan government as a Drake product through the Forest of Hope Association, and before that, the Gishwati Area Conservation Program. And that's where it sat for a while. until the fall of 2015 when they passed the law saying there would be such a national park. Now, the new law connects or proposes that eventually Gishwati and Makoro will be connected. The original gazette is two separate pieces that are not connected, with the provision that they will connect them later when they figure out how to do that. But the planning assumptions in the new law are slightly different than that of the model. And so there's a little bit of work to do there. It's also become clear that this 300 meters, 200 meters of corridor with a 50 meter buffer on each side, isn't big enough. That leaves too many areas exposed. There are some new studies that come out from other places that tell us that that's not big enough to give animals the sense of security they need to move through it easily. So it needs to be a wider corridor than that. And we are within a few days of submitting a proposal for foundation funding to essentially revise this model and begin acquiring the land for a corridor that's 1,000 meters wide, starting at Gishwati and moving out the first in miles, 15 miles or so, essentially planning the whole thing and acquiring the first 15 miles of the corridor to expand the existing reserve, and then to create the conditions and the demonstrations of success that will help us raise the money to do the rest of it. And that proposal is, you know, within a few days of being done, and it's being done as a collaboration between Drake and the Forest of Hope Association in Rwanda. So that's where we leave that chapter. Another unfinished story, but at least some progress to report. And then we come to crop breeding. This is the part of the story that got me involved in the first place. I'd like to thank my colleague Kimberly Hawkins at Oxford Brookes University for letting me use this photo. This is the coolest photo I've ever seen in my life. That is an actual chimpanzee stealing a watermelon. And she just happened to be in the right place at the right time and had the presence of mind to not say ooh, 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 but to grab for the camera and get a good shot of it. Crop breeding is when wild animals come out of a reserve area and steal the agricultural products that the humans are raising for themselves in the nearby lands. It's not unique to reserve areas. If you've ever had a home garden, you've dealt with crop breeding by the local creatures. So what do we know about it? Well, crop breeding occurs all over the world. Different species engage in it, everything from, you know, small animals, which are just considered a nuisance, up to and including elephants, which can be catastrophic for a crop. And so there is a lot of attention given in policy circles to what do we do about crop breeding. Surprisingly, there hasn't been all that much science about it. It's not particularly well understood. And the models that have been out there in the past are essentially distance driven. You know, 50 meters away from the edge is where you're safe. They don't work. They just, at the bottom line, do not work. At Gishwati, most of the damage is caused by chimpanzees when they come out of the forest and raid the corn, which is called maize locally. And actually, corn is not a native Rwandan crop. It was imported from this country about 130 years ago. But it is now a staple crop. It is a cash crop. It's also a subsistence crop for the farmers, especially in the Gishwati region. They raise this corn to feed their own livestock and to feed their families. To make it worse, when the chimpanzees at Gishwati raid a cornfield, they don't actually eat the corn. They knock the stalks down and they treat the stalks like sugar cane. Essentially, they're sucking out the pith because it's a sweet fluid. And they get calories from it and they like the taste of it. And then they leave the corn ears on the ground. So to add insult to injury, not only have you ruined the crop, but to the farmers, it looks like vandalism. It doesn't look like they're actually stealing the crop, because to the farmer, what's interesting is the corn. And they leave the corn behind. As recently as 2007, one of the chimpanzees who had come out of Gishwati to raid a cornfield was beaten to death with a stick. By a local farmer. And so it causes considerable local friction in this area. And it was, when I got involved in this, it was causing considerable resistance to the idea that this forest remain a reserve, because if it's a reserve, the chimpanzees will be there and the chimpanzees will raid our crops, and we don't want that. So this was a problem the Gishwati Area Conservation Program really wanted to solve. So in 2011, when I made my first trip, it was essentially reconnaissance. They invited me to come there to ask, you know, can you figure this out? And I didn't want to make any promises because I'd never worked on this problem before. And I said, now let me go look around and we'll see if I can figure something out. And so looking at their data for the last several years and hiking the sites where it had occurred, there were several patterns that came to mind. One is that raids occur near the forest edge. That's not rocket science. But the topography in that area is very complex. And it doesn't change quickly because this is old volcanic cones and craters. And so it's very hard rock underneath the topsoil. And so the shape is what it has been for a while and will be for a long time into the future. And so that topography makes it very difficult to see very far from ground level, because there may be outcroppings or upwellings that get in the way of your sight lines. And the raiding distance of how far out the chimpanzees seem to be going to make their raids varied a lot by location. And after I looked at all this data set and walked these sites, I came to the hypothesis that the chimpanzees were controlling how far they'd go out to raid by how far they could still go, how far they could go and still see their escape route back into the forest. And so it's a hypothesis more driven by a theory of animal cognition than anything. Can they see a path to get to safety from where they are? And if they can't see the ground out to the crop, they won't go out there because they don't know how they'd get back if they got caught. So in 2012, we spent part of the summer mapping the area along the boundary. Now this is the area that I told you about that is actually now going to be reforested into the national park. But at that time, this was the boundary of the reserve area. And you'll see there are crops planted all along here, and it's a complicated topography. So we spent a long time with GPS markers marking various kinds of points. We devised a methodology that would let us build a map of what the chimpanzees could and couldn't see from the edge of the forest. And so we had to estimate what they could see, not just what the shape of the land was. And so with our GPS, we mapped the line defining the forest boundary in practical terms, because the legal boundary and the actual physical boundary of the forest are not always in the same place. And the furthest point out where you could see your way back to the forest. And we did that on several different axes so that we could integrate this over time and build a map of the composite sight line, essentially, that the chimpanzees were using to make these estimates, if in fact this model worked. And then from these data, we developed these maps that we could use to make predictions. And this proof of concept study was an area that was about a kilometer and a half, almost a mile, along the edge of the forest. You just saw a picture of it. The blue line in this diagram is the mathematical aggregate of all the different estimation methods we used to say how far can the chimpanzees see the ground. The red areas are where crop raids occurred that following year against this map. And what we found was that the areas that were planted completely outside these sight lines were left alone. And the raiding that occurred outside the line only occurred in planting plots where the planting started inside the sight line. So there was a place they could go to raid the food that met this criterion of, I can see my way back to the forest. And then once they got out there, then they might go further. But they wouldn't initiate a raid if it started beyond that point. And it explained all the data perfectly well. So then the guy with the bad knees got invited back to Rwanda to map the boundary of the entire reserve. So that was the summer of 2014. What we wanted to do was map the agricultural terrain rather than map the whole reserve, because there's some places that a crop raid won't occur because there are no crops. And it turns out that in the period of time we were planning this trip before we got there, a substantial part of the northern reach of the reserve, you can see the reserve in this Google map here because it's where the trees are, a substantial part of the northern reach up here had been agricultural but had been leased off for tea plantations. The chimpanzees just don't care about tea. They're not interested in it. They won't leave the forest for it. And so everything from, here's the original plot where the proof of concept study happened. Everything from here up around here was not of interest to chimpanzees because it was not cropland anymore. Along here, there's a road that makes the boundary, and because of the rain patterns and the erosion, the road essentially wears its way down into the hill. And so you have this valley that provides an earth berm that visually cuts you off from what's behind it. And so most of the way along this line, you couldn't see what was on the other side of the berm. And so we ruled that out. We ended up mapping a several mile stretch across the southern reach, which made for a pretty good large scale test of the model. In the meantime, however, while we were planning to test our model, the local staff thought these results were so cool they should share them with the farmers right away. So they started having meetings with our local farmers and saying, if you plant, you know, if you do this thing here that they did, and this is all seat of the pants, they didn't have the GPS maps, they said how to estimate it, plant your attractive crops, the ones the chimpanzees raid, out beyond that line, you'll be good. And in 2014, there were no crop raids. Now, there were raids by jackals and mountain monkeys and golden monkeys, of other crops, but these are considered a nuisance because the scale is so small it doesn't destroy any substantial part of the crop tape. And so this is considered acceptable in the local parlance. It's the chimpanzees that were the problem. And when we did this accidental experiment where we implemented this thing on a larger scale than we thought we would, it worked, basically. We are now in an interesting position because there is an interesting dynamic in that a fairly substantial piece of that southern reach that was owned by one farmer has been sold off to a guy who wasn't at the meeting. And so we are now going through the growing season where you planted corn in places that everybody else knows you shouldn't. And so by the end of March, we'll have another set of data based on, okay, when you go back to the way you were before, do the chimpanzees come back out and steal your corn? And I don't know the answer to that yet, either. So where this one stands is that in September, when I was in Rwanda planning the last stages of the J-term class, I had lunch with a couple of the head wardens of the various national parks, and they immediately took the results and started applying them in Volcanoes National Park and Yungwe National Park. And arranged for me to give a briefing to the entire conservation department of the Rwandan Development Board. So these projects that we do as students actually do make a substantial difference sometimes. Now to finish up, I wanted to tell you a little bit about some of the community engagement work that goes around this, because as I said, you can't just work in isolation on the science piece of it. It becomes a bigger project than that. And our partners in all this are the Forest of Hope Association, whose mission actually is somewhat different than our intent. Their mission is community engagement and protecting the forest. They engage science, they engage other things as necessary to make these things happen, but they're really about the forest and this community in this region. Forest of Hope is a Rwandan NGO that invented itself in 2012 when the Great Ape Trust said, we're out of money, we're leaving. And so now this is an entirely Rwandan-driven organization. We partner with them on some things we lead, most things they lead. It has turned into a remarkable collaboration that I'm very fortunate to be part of. And the things that we get involved in there are outreach to the schools. This is the Batanga School, which is near the reforestation site that I showed you. This is where you park. That wasn't supposed to advance. There we go. This is where you park to walk in that hour to get to that site. And every time we show up, it's been a few months since we were there last time, it is so isolated that we are probably the last white people they saw and the next white people they will see. And so they usually let classes out so the students can come meet us. And we talk to them and we spend time with them because it is pretty cool. This is the Kavakura Women's Craft Cooperative. It is entirely composed of women. It is something that the Rwandan organization, the Forest of Hope, has sponsored. They negotiate distribution agreements at hotels in the touristy areas of the country, mostly Kigali. They help train them to use the forest resources sustainably so that they can continue to do this work. They help them run a small craft shop out in the area of the Gishwati Forest that tourists will stop by at. That's Konsole. She is one of the Batwa people who are the local indigenous people that runs the craft store for them and is actually kind of in charge of the cooperative. They do marvelous work. If you stop by my office sometime, I have several of their things in my office because I can't resist buying stuff when I'm in there. They just have such wonderful craft in the work that they do, and it's very well made and it always triggers good memories for me. We try to support the schools in the area. The Gishwati Foundation, which is the group that we formed here, does a book drive and takes textbooks and children's books in particular. When someone is traveling over there, you fill the rest of your luggage allowance with that. And the field station staff actually have a daily English language reading group because the upper grades are now taught in English for the last 10 years in Rwanda. The government just decided one day that was their future, and they shifted by making an announcement that we will teach in English now. Over the space of a couple of years, all the schools by about age 10 have shifted from teaching in French to teaching English because this is a Francophone country. And the books for this English language reading group were all provided by the Gishwati Foundation. This last January, with support from several sources, from the Olson Service Learning Fund, from the Gishwati Foundation, from U.S. Soccer, from the Vision Soccer Academy in Waukee, from the Drake Soccer Program, the students gathered up over 150 books and enough materials to equip, I think, 8 teams, they said they finally came up with, at the eco clubs that the FHA has set up in the schools in the region. So that they can have an organized soccer program rather than just playing. And they are arranging tournaments and competitions among the eco clubs, and now it's becoming a big point of pride that you're one of these teams. And they are selected as a reward for engaging in the sustainability activities that the clubs do. And so when we were there, we actually had the chance to play with some of the village children in Kinahira, and spent the afternoon playing soccer. And there was a football out there for reasons I've never understood, American football, and a couple of frisbees. It was a lot of fun for everybody, and there were a whole lot of tears when they parted, because I think both the kids and the Drake students were having a really good time at that. They also sponsor cultural preservation activities. The Batwa people are, in common parlance, they're the pygmies, and they are historically marginalized people in most of the Albertine Rift. Their cultures are not generally respected. They tend to keep to themselves and not integrate themselves with the other things that are happening in the country, and so they don't have much voice in the political process. And the Forest of Hope Association arranges for cultural demonstrations with visiting groups for a fee, because that then gives these people a reason not to invade the forest and strip it of resources. It also helps preserve their cultural practices, which are rapidly going away. They arranged a dance demonstration for our students when we were there, and wouldn't you know, by the time they were done, they had dragged every one of us up there to dance with them. And no, I'm not showing you my picture.
I can later.
So, Drake goes to Rwanda. It's a whole bunch of unfinished stories. It's a bunch of interlocking puzzle pieces, and we're not quite sure what the whole picture looks like yet. But it's people who can use our skills to solve problems that need to be solved. And it has provided, for the last 5 years, an incredibly rich learning environment for Drake students, and I'm really grateful to be part of it. And so I'll thank you for your attention and tell you if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Do you have any thoughts on what global climate change is going to do to this area?
Got an hour? Yeah, it's going to be a really interesting picture, because we already see, when you go to Rwanda, you take anti-malarial medications. Even though in Gishwati Forest, the mosquitoes that carry malaria are essentially non-existent because of the altitude and because it gets cool enough at night that it disrupts their bodily cycles, the mosquitoes are being found farther and farther up the mountain slopes. And that's an indication that the temperature change is noticeable by the animals that are exploiting the environment. They can go there now. They're not yet in Gishwati, but they are getting closer and closer by the year. The first year I went there, people were very puzzled, because I arrived 10 days before the clockwork start of the fall rainy season. It was usually so precise they could tell you within plus or minus 2 days when the rains would come. And it started raining while I was there, which was a full 10 days early. And that was thought to be a blip. Since then, it has been much more variable, plus or minus about 3 weeks. And so you're already starting to see the effects of instability in the climate, even in an equatorial place, which doesn't have a lot of climate variability to start with. So the effects will be enormous, and we just don't know yet what they're going to be.
You mentioned that they have to buy the land for these corridors, but it looked to me as if there would be more than just the land, but there must be some buildings on these corridors. So what kind of resistance is there potentially for people who either build those or don't want those buildings to go or whatever, because you have to stop that, right, to somehow. And so how are they doing that?
That's an excellent question. Part of the reason the corridor design exercise included mapping human structures was to try to address that by finding corridor paths that minimized how many structures were included. The government in Rwanda is somewhat authoritarian, and they treat the concept of eminent domain much more broadly than in this country. There isn't the litigation cycle that you have here. So I'll give you an example. After I'd been there two or three times, the government figured out that a lot of these buildings that had been built very, very hastily after the genocide were built with a standard kind of an A-frame roof, which meant that half of the rain coming onto that roof drained into the street. And so they announced one day that by a date 2.5 years hence, they announced a date by which any building that drained into the street would be knocked down. basically mandating you got to rebuild your roof from this, if the street's over here, to this, so that it drains away from the street. And you know, the next time I was there were scaffolds everywhere of people rebuilding their roofs to comply with that. So the government is not shy about saying we're going to do this. They are becoming much more sensitive, even the time I've worked there, with trying to be collaborative with the community, trying to hear people out, trying to find solutions that offend the fewest people. The government is acquiring some sophistication in how to do this. So they are trying to work with local people and essentially find where the social resistance is in the sociological sense and work around that. They also recognize they're going to have to buy a lot of this land. And so this project that we are about to propose, probably by the end of the week if everything goes well, involves a large part of the budget is to buy the land. Once the design is finished, we know what land it is that we need. We'll buy the land, but it's land is expensive in Rwanda because, you know, as Will Rogers said, they aren't making any more of it. Other questions? Yeah. Back
here. You talked about some of the problems you're addressing, but we did not learn much about your research on primates. Were you able to do some basic research with the chimpanzees while you were there?
It's a good question. I have a colleague who is actually in my old job at Westchester University, just by coincidence, who is studying dietary patterns of the chimpanzees in Gishwati. When I got into this, I wasn't at all sure what kind of research I would be doing about chimpanzees. I actually have made trips to Rwanda where I did not see a chimpanzee, because what I'm doing is the work along the edge of the interface between the chimpanzees and the local human population. And so there are times when, as much as I love primates and would love to go hiking in the forest, I have work to do, and it's out here. And so there have been times I haven't seen a chimpanzee when I've gone there. So it's not about the chimpanzees exactly, except it's about the chimpanzees' impact on the environment because the people are also there. So it's a much more complicated problem than that. And to be honest, I'm finding that pretty fascinating right now. Charlie, you got a question?
Yeah, so tell me a little bit more about the crop rating. Is this like an individual chimp that goes out, or is there bands of them goes out? What's the sociology of that behavior?
All of the above.
Okay.
It's very situational. It is almost always at night. And so the actual observational data about who's doing what are nearly non-existent. Uh-huh. We track crop rating from the signature it leaves behind most of the time. And in the big data set we got, where we could identify what crop and what animal had done it, we used a lot of local farmers who were informants who have seen these patterns before and could say that was a jackal, that was a mountain monkey. We actually have the first photographic evidence that mountain monkeys do in fact dig up sweet potatoes, which is really problematic because that was one of the crops that they advised people to plant because the monkeys will leave it alone. And the monkeys have figured out that it's not to be left alone, it's to be eaten, and that's now causing some new shifts. And that may be the next problem we work on, is how do you convince the monkeys to leave stuff alone once you've told the farmers that they will? Other questions? Yes, in the back.
What kind of resistance do you foresee for future of Gishwati, and once you start doing corridors, how will people start reacting to that, or is that something that you don't know yet?
Well, we don't really know, but part of the reason for all the community engagement work that they're doing, and Forest of Hope has got three other projects that I didn't tell you about because we are not directly involved with them, but they're more community engagement, they're more along the lines of trying to make sure that the people in the region come to see the forest as a resource. There is a, right across, our field station's in the village of Kinihira, and you know, I'm always the best show in town when I'm there, so there are always kids lined up along the fence looking in. And right across the street is a little shop. And 3 years ago, Papa Benjamin, who owns the shop, poured a concrete pad for a bed and breakfast. He hasn't built it yet because until the national park was declared, there wouldn't be enough tourist traffic to justify the loan he'd have to take to finish the building. When I talked to him in January, he said he was going to build it. People have begun to see that if the forest is here and the tourists come to see the forest, that that's a source of income in an area where cash crops are few and far between. This is a subsistence economy. And so the local people recognize if they can get foreigners to come and spend money, that's almost better than anything else they could do. And so it's up to the people who are trying to develop the forest to make sure it's done in a way that's sustainable and not exploitive, so that that help to that region continues for a long time rather than just as the locusts moving through and then moving on. Yeah.
Is there any, can people benefit from the forest through foraging,
you know, nuts, berries, medicinal plants,
There aren't a lot of things in the forest that people treat as edible. There are some medicinal plants. There actually is artisanal gold mining and mining for some of the rare earth metals that are used in electronics manufacture. There are a couple of minerals where a good sized lump of it is like a year's income to these folk. And so keeping them from doing damage in the forest when they do that is one of the projects that Forest of Hope is working on. You know, it's hard to tell somebody that if you dig in the right place, you can get a year's worth of income in a half an hour, but you shouldn't do it. So what they're trying to do is figure out a way to manage it so that it doesn't harm the forest in ways that it can't come back from easily. Eventually, it may get to the point where they would try to keep it from happening altogether, but right now, they're working very hard to get the community to recognize that this forest is a resource as long as they don't wreck it. And that's what the eco clubs are for, is to get into the younger population to treat the forest as a cultural resource as well as an economic potential resource. And they're making good inroads on that. Yes?
Just wondering one thing about those corridors that you're trying to purchase. Just curious how much they cost and how you're getting the funds to make those purchases.
The land in Rwanda costs about $2,500 an acre in round numbers, which is extraordinarily expensive by the standards of that part of the world. I mean, it's cheap for Iowa farmland, but it's expensive nearly anywhere else. There are foundations that are dedicated to saving rainforests and eco-preservation that can sometimes come up with lumps of money to buy property, and that's the route we are going with this next proposal. We're relatively confident because of the way the invitation to apply came about, but there's no guarantee of that. What we will do in the long term, we're making this up as we go. We didn't know a year ago we would have this opportunity, and so we are, you know, trying to move very quickly on it now because it's here and it won't be here in a month. It's an ongoing puzzle. It's one we haven't completely solved yet, but it's an exercise of one brick at a time. I mean, you solve the problems today that you can find the resources to solve today, and that narrows the problem space for the next time. And that, as far as we can tell, that's all you can do. Even if all that does is a 1 kilometer wide spike out from the reserve and then stops there, you've actually added a considerable amount of area to the reserve that way. If it's allowed to reforest, then it will be usable by the animals even if it doesn't go anywhere. And so we see it as a win, even if it never results in a completed proposal. I'll tell you an example. We were in Akagera National Park, which is the savanna park at the far end of Rwanda. And the head ranger we were meeting with, actually he's the CEO of the park as well, told us that things like moving rhinoceroses across the continent to establish new populations, but that's easy to raise money for because it's such a visible, you know, it's a big sexy thing, and so people want to give money to that. Saving the rainforest is kind of in that category right now, and it's not like the tap is open and money's flowing, but you can find sources of limited amounts of funding, and you can assemble that into packages then that do more altogether than any one of them could do alone. And that's the approach they're taking.
Well, in connection with the climate change talks, there are forest preservation parts of that package that are attracting funding, right?
There are, and there are carbon banks that I haven't talked about. Actually, David Kordhari on this campus developed a new method of calculating carbon sequestration in rainforests so that we could estimate just how much carbon was tied up in the biomass in Gishwati. That paper, maybe next week, will be out. I mean, it's in the publication process now. And the idea originally was to try to monetize that, to try to find somebody who would buy that as a carbon offset for something they were doing. And that market sort of went scurry a couple of years ago, but it's not impossible that would happen in the future. We're trying to put all the tools together so that we can move on opportunities when they happen. Any last questions? One more? Okay. Thank you very much. I've had a good time tonight.
Thank you, Mike.